In March 2022, there was a heat wave so intense that temperatures rose by 40 degrees above what is normal for the time of year. One of the largest temperature differences ever recorded anywhere on Earth. That would be like seeing the mercury soar above 50 degrees Celsius in London. So you might be wondering how on earth you missed it. And the answer is because maximum temperatures only just crept above 0 degrees Celsius. Not exactly sweltering. That heat wave was in East Antarctica, and it was caused by a particularly good example of a weather feature that scientists are starting to focus more and more of their attention on. Atmospheric rivers. And before you think, hold up, what the hell is an atmospheric river? I've got just the person to explain it.
My name is Jonathan Willey. I'm a meteorologist and climatologist with a focus on polar regions.
Jonathan is a climate researcher at ETH Zurich and the author of two recent papers exploring the causes of that March 2022 heatwave. He's also published a stack of great papers on Antarctic atmospheric rivers, and to my mind, he's the Antarctic atmospheric river guy.
An atmospheric river is one of the main forms of moisture transport on the planet. They take moisture from the subtropical regions to polar regions in the form of elongated bands of very concentrated moisture.
Atmospheric rivers are literally like rivers in the sky, taking water from one part of the planet to another. Because of that, when an atmospheric river hits, it brings warmer, wetter, and cloudier conditions. And atmospheric rivers are behind lots of extremes, especially floods and extreme rain or snowfall events.
Generally, the impacts of atmospheric rivers can be quite extreme. When they make landfall in mid-latitude regions, famously in California, they can result in extreme snowfall in mountain regions and flooding conditions in lower elevation areas.
The impacts of atmospheric rivers are not insignificant. In February 2024, two atmospheric rivers battered the coast of California, bringing winds strong enough to down trees and triggering mudslides, flash floods, and power outages across the region. It rained so much that one scientist warned of the chances of biblical flooding. But in the Arctic and Antarctica, there aren't so many power lines that can be affected by atmospheric rivers. So why do we care about their impacts in the polar regions? Let's go back to the expert, shall we?
Some of the main impacts that we observe from polar atmospheric rivers include extreme snowfall events, temperature extremes. We've observed collapses of ice shelves, including the Larsen A and Larsen B ice shelves on the Antarctic Peninsula. We know that they can decay sea ice, especially in the marginal areas around Antarctica and in the Arctic too. I think especially in the spring, they actually delay the sea ice regrowth in Arctic regions.
Simply put, atmospheric rivers at the poles can deliver huge amounts of snowfall and even rain in a relatively short amount of time. Plus, they can raise temperatures considerably, in some cases enough to permit melting to occur. That can have impacts on ice shelves and sea ice in the polar regions, which has knock-on impacts on sea level and the rate of climate change that we experience worldwide. And there's no better example of how all of these impacts can come together than March 2022.
This event was what we consider a black swan event, something that was never thought to be possible until we actually observed it. Now, the amount of heat that was transported in this event actually caused extensive temperature records across the Antarctic ice sheets. In fact, it created one of the largest temperature anomalies ever recorded anywhere on the planet.
March 2022 was a special case because it was so extreme, bringing huge amounts of moisture from lower latitudes and dumping it on the Antarctic ice sheet. It also brought huge amounts of heat, driving melting and rainfall around the edges.
In addition to these temperature anomalies, there was a really extensive area of heavy snow across a large part of the eastern Antarctic ice sheet. It actually helped make 2022 a rare positive mass balance year for the entire Antarctic ice sheet. There was also limited melting along the coastal regions of eastern Antarctica, but because this event happened during the winter transition period, the temperatures were a bit limited in terms of how much melting could actually occur.
The health of an ice sheet can be measured by its mass balance. Much like a bank balance, its status depends on how much you put in versus how much you take out. Because the atmospheric river hit in March, when temperatures are usually around minus 35 degrees Celsius in East Antarctica, the mass balance was positive. That's because all the losses from melting were offset by the gains from snowfall. But if that atmospheric river had hit in summer, it might have been a very different story indeed, because melting can be a big part of the picture. Diligent viewers of this channel will know that I recently spent some time in Berlin. Unfortunately for me, I wasn't only there to enjoy its UNESCO-protected techno scene. I was actually mostly there to work on a project exploring the impacts of atmospheric rivers on the polar regions. And while I was in Germany, I ran some model simulations of that March 2022 heatwave to complement some work done by colleagues there. We tracked the atmospheric rivers in our models, and I zoomed in on that March 2022 case to see what we could learn. I found peak melt fluxes of up to 200 watts per square meter, which, for context, is huge for winter. If those peak melt rates were sustained, it would take just over a week to melt an entire meter of surface snow. And in summer, we can see peak melt rates 4 or 5 times that, which translates into very rapid melting during these kind of extreme events.
In the future, as the planet continues to warm, we expect the impacts of the atmospheric rivers to become more crucial for determining the fate of the polar ice caps.
As the atmosphere warms, it can hold onto more and more water vapor. That's why we see more intense downpours in summer when it's hotter, and why the tropics experience much more concentrated periods of rainfall. And it's also why we are seeing progressively more intense rain as we are heating up our climate. In the UK, we've seen more rain in the last 18 months than in any other 18-month period on record, which, although record-breaking, is exactly what we expect from our warming climate. And unfortunately for Brits, and for everyone who has to endure listening to us drone on about the weather, we're going to see more extreme rainfall as the planet heats up. Now, to explain why this is, you'll have to permit me a small deviation into thermodynamical theory. Let's think about a chunk or parcel of air in the atmosphere. That's in this cup. In a climate unchanged by human actions, our atmosphere can hold on to a certain amount of water before it becomes saturated. But in a warmer climate, that parcel of air can hold on to a little more. We can figure out exactly how much more using the Clausius-Clapeyron equation. It tells us the saturation vapor pressure of air, i.e. the holding capacity of the atmosphere. And for every 1 degree Celsius that the temperature rises, the saturation vapor pressure rises by 7%, which means that a warmer atmosphere is a wetter atmosphere. Extreme rainfall and snowfall are often delivered by atmospheric rivers, and the increase in the atmosphere's water carrying capacity, fueled by rising temperatures, means that we are likely to see more intense atmospheric rivers more often in the future. And given all the impacts these guys can have, that will mean more extremes in Antarctica and closer to home.
We know that extreme weather events like atmospheric rivers will become more common in the future as the planet continues to warm. We know their intensity will also increase. So events like the March 2022 atmospheric river could potentially become more of a frequent occurrence in the future.
As we continue to pump greenhouse gases into the atmosphere and raise temperatures, extremes are getting more extreme. If we don't stop doing that, events like March 2022 might become less Black Swan and more Swan Lake. Still a rare spectacle, but touring worldwide. The impacts of these events in the polar regions matter to us all because they affect the overall health of our ice sheets and therefore sea level. And when they make landfall closer to home, they can bring weather conditions that can damage homes, infrastructure, and even claim lives. So the sooner we act to curb climate change, the fewer of these extremes we'll have to cope with. Thanks again to Jonathan for sharing his knowledge on this subject. It's always great to get an expert on the channel to talk about the latest science. And if you want to check out any of his work, then I've stuck some of the links down here. And if you want to support the channel, you can become a subscriber on Patreon. Thanks to all my awesome patrons on there, I am able to spend more time making these videos better and to get brilliant guests to come on and talk about their work. Your support really does help. Okay, tschüss!